Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome you all to the library lecture series. Thanks for coming out on a Monday afternoon. I'm Tim Pyatt, and I'm the dean of the library here. And it is my great pleasure today to get to introduce my friend and colleague, Michele Gillespie, the dean of the college. So we share the bond. We were both appointed deans in the summer of 2015. And while we're still sort of learning the ropes here, one of the things I really appreciate and benefit from Michele is her experience at Wake Forest, because she's been here as a faculty member since 1999, and it's really great. She's one of the first people I go to for history, institutional history, but obviously, as you can see from today, lots of history, so it's great. Great. So Michele was named the Cayley Family Professor of History in 2003, and she served as Associate Provost for Academic Initiatives from 2007 to 2010. And in 2013, she became the first Wake Forest faculty member to be honored with an endowed presidential chair, the Presidential Endowed Chair of Southern History, which recognizes and supports faculty who excel in both academic leadership and outstanding scholarship. And I believe we're now up to 10 of those chairs. So that's you're another trailblazer. She's a noted teacher, scholar, historian, and author. And one of the things I really like about Michele is that she really balances her academic rigor with integrating with community engagement into both her work and classes. Her efforts to engage students, and use interesting engage, that's one of the words I associate with Michele, from the engaged liberal arts, the engaged humanities, engaged students. And that's one of the things I think is really one of her great things that she brings to Wake Forest, because her efforts actually to engage students have been recognized at both the campus level and the state level with awards. And one of the things I particularly like, the project that maybe it's because it was what she was working on when I first came here, was her project to have her honor students engage with doing oral history interviews of the parishioners at the St. Benedict the Moor church here in Winston-Salem. And that church, actually, that project is actually a partnership here with ZSR, and Tanya Zanish-Belcher has actually worked with her then to preserve those interviews and the special collections here and make those available for research. So great, sort of nice life cycle of research there. Michele has also published several award-winning books, as well as articles and book chapters, and today I'm really excited about hearing about her most recent book, Katharine and R. Reynolds, Partners of Fortune in Making the New South. And this really represents 10 years of in-depth research on R.J. Reynolds and his very progressive wife, Katharine Reynolds, whose 300 acres of property we sit on right now. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to Michele.
Thank you so much, Tim. I'm so honored to be your partner in so many things that we get to do together. I think the library and academics go hand in hand, are a really wonderful marriage. And I've been really fortunate to be able to partner with so many wonderful people in this library in so many ways, and I'm so grateful. You made me think about working on this project and the ways that I lived in this library many, many hours to do so, the ways we've used I've used the databases, the archives, interlibrary loan to get me articles and pieces of information that I couldn't get elsewhere, and just going through the stacks and finding books and finding resources I wouldn't have been. So the library has been such a critical partner, and it's been really exciting to see all the innovations and the broadening of the influence of the library in so many exciting ways, not only for us faculty members, but really for our students and what they're able to do. And the long reach, I think, that the library, I may have used it in a traditional way, but the library has really long reaches with digitization and through electronic means, that I think means we can create more knowledge and share more knowledge in more democratic ways than we've ever been to be able to do that before. And I really, really appreciate this. You should also know that Tim knows Southern history, that he comes from University of North Carolina, where he was in the Southern Historical Collection. And I can't tell you how excited I was that when I'd heard that he was coming to Wake Forest, and what fun it's been to partner with him. I have to tell you that when I came to Wake Forest in 1999, I realized that the Reynolds were predominant everywhere. Every place I went in this city, there were monuments to the Reynolds, there were buildings with Reynolds names on it, and of course here on our own campus, everything had Reynolds family names or Babcock family names. And I was really, really curious about this family as a Southern historian and as someone who was making a new home here. And then I ventured over to the Rinalda House Museum of American Art, And here I really got the Reynolds family history up close and personal. And that just intrigued me. I thought, here is history in the making in my own new backyard. And then I discovered, thanks to the wonderful archivist at Rinalda House, I've worked with three archivists there now, I discovered that Rinalda House Museum of American Art had an amazing archive about the family, the Reynolds family papers. And it struck me that doing really good history can begin in your own backyard. And literally, it was beginning in my own professional backyard, as it were. I also had something else that was really, really important. And there's someone here who represents that really special something else. And that was early on here, found a group of three other wonderful women writers who were writing biographies. And we created a writing group together called BioBrio. And Peggy Smith, who is here, was one of the members of BioBrio, Emily Wilson, and Anna Rubino. And we met together for several years and wrote our chapters and our proposals and shared them with each other. And that really was an opportunity for me to get this book going. And each of us have published a book out of that BioBrio. So all of you writers out here, make a writing group, get a writing group, and you can do really extraordinary things with sharing your work with each other and gaining ideas and perspective from each other. And then the kind of two big things I want to frame for you today, two kind of overarching themes. And the first of those is what it means to be at Wake Forest and get an education here. Actually, I got an education by doing this book, and I was able to give an education in some ways because I was able to partner with my students in so many aspects of doing the research for this project. And when Dean Pyatt talks about engagement, the students and I were able to engage together in big questions that fascinated us, that interest us. So I can tell you, when I taught my two different sections of my course on the history of the New South, my students work with me on demographic materials and census data, and we crunch those numbers together. And my students learned about how neighborhoods work by looking at census data from 1900, 1910, 1920, and how that changed over time and what neighborhoods look like in downtown Winston in the Third Ward. So they were learning, and I was learning, and we were gaining information together. I also was able to use resources through Eureka, our Undergraduate Research and Creativity Center, and had probably seven different students over about 7 years' time who did research with me. One of those was Andrew Kennedy, who worked with me in the State Archives. He's now a historian. Another is Eleanor Davidson, who worked on the 1918 race riot in Winston-Salem with me. She is now a hospital administrator in Houston, and all of that data crunching that we did together has played out really well in her hospital administration career. Another student, Liz Lundeen, and I went to Winston-Salem State University archives, and we went through the Simon Atkins papers there. Simon Atkins, a noted African-American educator who founded Winston-Salem State University, and before that, Slater Academy. And so we sat there for weeks and went through those papers together and looked at the ways, found out the ways that Simon Atkins and R.J. Reynolds were actually very closely connected in ways that we hadn't known before. So Wake Forest and that opportunity for education is mutual for faculty and students together. And I know that I've become a better teacher scholar because of that work, that opportunity with the students, and because of the kind of partnerships we've been able to make with each other. So that's one overarching theme to make you think about. And the second one is indeed more political. And I know we've all been watching the news and getting our tweets and paying close attention to things that have been happening lately in the nation and in the world. And I think many of us have said to ourselves, wow, there's a lot going on here. And we're asking ourselves, how are our voices heard? What can we do to make our voices heard? And what can we do to make our own part of the world live up to the hopes and dreams that we have in pro humanitate? And it struck me that in many, many ways then, as we look to the local for change to make a difference, part of looking at the local is knowing the history of where we have come from. And so one of the great things for me in thinking about where we are today, where we will go, even as we launch Wake Downtown and we think about those warehouses that were once tobacco manufactories and are now thriving thriving opportunities for learning about biomedicine. I think knowing that local piece is really, really critical. Knowing that past as prologue as really, really critical. And the other thing I want to say about being local is that even as we look at the local as a way to maybe simplify or clarify things, I want to challenge you on that point. I want you to think, especially when we look back at R.J. Reynolds and Katharine Reynolds, about the complexities of the world that they were in, the ways in which they had power and the ways in which they didn't, the ways in which they were progressive and the ways in which they were not. When I talk with people about this book, people walk away sometimes and they want to say, Katharine and RJR were heroes and we should really embrace them. And I will tell you right now, I don't think you should. Other people will say they were villains. They were horrible, horrible people, and we shouldn't give them the time of day. You shouldn't have spent 10 years doing your work in this. And I would say they aren't neat and tidy villains either. They're much more complex than that. And knowing their story, knowing how the city of Winston was shaped by them and how the people of Winston shaped them, and thinking about those complexities is something that I bring to bear when I think about the local world we're in today. So what I'm going to do is kind of give you a narrative overview of some of the key parts of their story, and then I will stop and welcome any questions or comments that you might have. The one thing about this project that is kind of a bit challenging maybe in terms of doing traditional biography is that I didn't want to focus just on Katharine or just on R.J. Reynolds. I really wanted to use these two people as a way to tell the history of a place and how a place and a people was changing. So ostensibly they are kind of at the forefront of the story and drive it. But on the other hand, I realized very quickly early on that there were so many other people who were shaping their lives and who were affected by the things that they did, that this ended up being a kind of history that is both a business history and economic history, and that it also married with women's and cultural and social history. And so I got a lot of, pats on the back, I guess, for putting kinds of histories together that traditionally don't go together. And I think you'll see that with my talk today. So let me start out here with these images. It's all connected, isn't it? Because if we look at us right in here, here we are, right, in the Z. Smith Reynolds Library, which is named for Katharine and RJR's youngest son, Smith Reynolds, who died very mysteriously, not clear if it was a suicide or murder, as we still don't know, in the summer of 1932, whose fortune was then turned into the Z. Smith Reynolds Foundation, and we have been very fortunate to have funding from Z. Smith Reynolds Foundation, and as Tim said, to have the land on which we've been able to build this university. And here is the Rinalda House, Museum of American Art, and the estate that Katharine essentially built in the 19-teens. And RJR's tobacco products, or the tobacco products that we have today, the cigarettes that we have today, Camel stretches back to its market release in 1914. That market release timed with World War I, and putting Camel cigarettes in our U.S. soldiers' packs, getting our soldiers addicted and kind of building a nice market, a long-term market there. But the wealth that came from this helped to create one of the sort of star cities of North Carolina. By 1920, Winston-Salem was the biggest city in North Carolina, if you can imagine that. Winston-Salem had all of the urban problems that New York and Chicago did by 1920, including the first case of cocaine busting in North Carolina was here in Winston-Salem. So there was more wealth here pretty quickly early on. And I know we probably don't think about Winston-Salem as being sort of the most urban, biggest metropolis, but in 1920, it was a pretty happening place. In a city that not only was built off of the rapid industrialization that came with tobacco and also with Hanes and textiles, that rapid industrialization, but also a commitment that may have come from the Moravian community that was here earlier to the arts as well. So the money that came out of rapid industrialization built a city of the arts that we are all beneficiaries of as well. Did I take us all the way around? Okay, I did. All right, let's move forward. Let's move actually back. I think we're going to move. We are not moving. So here are Katharine and R.J. Reynolds. This is their wedding photographs. Okay, their wedding portraits. This is 1905. I'm taking you back to 1905 when Winston was just Winston. It was not Winston-Salem yet. This is Katharine who went to Paris for her honeymoon with her husband. And this is a beautiful gown that was created in a Parisian fashion house for her. And here is R.J. Reynolds. The first thing that probably strikes you when you look at them, because this is 1905, is the disparity in their ages. Katharine was born in 1880. She died in 1924, so she only lived to be 44. Actually, she didn't quite hit her 44th birthday. R.J.R. was born in 1850, and he died in 1918. So he was 30 years older than Katharine. It's probably important for you to know that they were first cousins once removed. Okay, so they grew up together. They knew each other. They didn't grow up together because there were 30 years difference. but they did. Their families knew each other. Katharine's husband was RJR's father's brother. Is their relationship? He grew up in Patrick County, on the largest plantation in Patrick County, 150 slaves on the eve of the Civil War. So he was a boy growing up in one of the wealthiest, on one of the wealthiest plantations, in the wealthiest families in that part of southern Virginia. In contrast, Katharine grew up in Mount Airy, North Carolina, in a small town. All right, so let me start with RJR here. So RJR grew up one of nine living children. His parents had 18 children, so 16 children, nine lived. He was the second oldest son. RJR's father, Hardin, was a very sort of entrepreneurial, acquisitive man. He was second generation in Patrick County. He not only had a tobacco plantation, but he manufactured the tobacco on his estate, and he had his sons put it in wagons, and it was plug tobacco, chewing tobacco, and they would go out into the mountains of the Appalachian Mountains, and they would go to Tennessee and Virginia and South Carolina, on down into northern Alabama, and sell their plug tobacco. So RJR at 17, 18 years old is going out into pretty wild, pretty dangerous places, selling this tobacco out of the wagon and kind of learning how to deal with people. And many, many people attribute his comfort as an adult and in his business and his corporation with that early training of working with all kinds of people from all walks of life. RJR's family went through the Civil War. RJR's oldest brother went to war. RJR was too young. Many of the slaves on the plantation saw this as an opportunity to get the hell out of Dodge and ran away. Some slaves ended up staying on the plantation, but when freedom came, many picked up and left as well. And there's an incredible letter in the Reynolds family papers where RJR's father says, "I don't know what to do. I've lost everything. I have no value anymore." Remember, he'd been very wealthy, very entrepreneurial, very successful. "All of my labor is gone. I don't know what to do." And RJR and his brother said, "You know what? We'll pick up the pieces and we will move forward on this." And I think one of the interesting aspects about the RJR and his generation is that he knew the families that he was working with, the freed people's families that he was working with, and sort of figuring out how you take a problem and move forward on with this problem. And that was sort of very characteristic of RJR. RJR also recognized that probably running your own tobacco manufacturing was not the way to go, especially when you don't have any way to get the tobacco to market except through wagons back to the Appalachians. He was not a good student. He was a terrible student. He went to Emory and Henry College for 2 years and basically took math the whole time, and then left Emory and Henry, did not get a degree. He wound up in Baltimore, and he went to a business school in Baltimore. While he was in Baltimore, Baltimore was the mecca for trains and train transportation and new markets, and he picked up all of that information, and he carried it in his head and said, "You know what, the future is not in having in growing tobacco on the old plantations. The future is tobacco manufacturing and finding the right place where you can have warehouses and manufacturing and cheap labor. And so he decided to come to Winston-Salem, or Winston. Winston, he thought, was essentially the belt buckle in the golden leaf tobacco agricultural area of North Carolina and Southern Virginia. He moved here right as they were getting a little train connection from Greensboro. And you can see up in the top corner, 1875, he bought this land for this factory from the Moravians for a small amount of money. And word is that he lived in that manufacturing in the up in the attic, and that he had no electricity. There was no electricity at that time. And he relied on about 9 African-American men to work with him to make that manufacturing go. And then this is a postcard, but here's the image of the factories that he had built and the scale of his plug tobacco industry, how much it had grown by 1902. So you can see that he was right, that there was a market for this chewing tobacco, that if he could get it to the trains and get it out fast, he would be very, very successful very quickly. And he was. Two images that I think are such a wonderful contrast to get you to feel how fast Winston changed in the early 20th century. The upper is in the late 1890s, where all the farmers bring their tobacco in their wagons to the sales. And you get a sense, horse and wagon, right, pulling into town. This is only 20 years later down here, to see how quickly he was able to really industrialize. And you see the sort of the contours of a 20th century city here in only 20 years' time. And I would point out to you, this is where Wake Downtown is right now, right? And the whole Innovation Quarter is where this is now. The building that we're in Wake Downtown, Building 60, was not built yet. That was a late 1930s, 1940s building. But it gives you a sense then of the market for his products. And by 1920, he was not only selling chewing tobacco, he was now selling Prince Albert tobacco for pipes, and he was selling the Camels that I referenced and other cigarettes that I was referencing earlier. The portrait on the left is the sort of the portrait that R.J. Reynolds' company likes to use and has hung in its corporate headquarters for years and years and years. Contrast that one with the next one that I think gets the real R.J. Reynolds for you. This is R.J. Reynolds, probably about 1914. He chewed tobacco and spit, but he does have a little cigar in his hand here. It's a New York studio portrait. And the reason I like to show it to you is I think you get more of a sense of who this guy was. And the other thing that I want to sort of emphasize to you is that from 1875 to 1900 or so, he was a quintessential entrepreneur. He was selling that plug tobacco. He was affixing other companies' labels to his tobacco. He was just kind of moving and making it work in every way he could make it work. Kind of quintessential 19th century entrepreneur. Then in the 1890s, Buck Duke from down the road, Buck Duke, who had already invested in cigarette manufacturing and was selling cigarettes in new numbers, decided he was going to create the American tobacco monopoly. And he bought up every tobacco manufacturing company that he could find over and over again. The only tobacco company he was not interested in, it seemed, or one of the few, was R.J. Reynolds Tobacco Company. The reason he wasn't interested in R.J. Reynolds Tobacco Company was because he thought chewing tobacco was, you know, like behind the times. This was a world where people were moving to pipe tobacco and cigarettes, right? Much more sophisticated, right? What the new middle class would smoke. He had no interest in smoking chewing tobacco, so he didn't. He didn't come to R.J. Reynolds. R.J. Reynolds, what I figured out in my research, went to Buck Duke. He went to Buck Duke, and he said, look, I've built my company so big so quickly in the 1890s that I'm in big time debt. And in fact, his top management left him in the early 1890s because he had gone into debt so fast, so quickly. And he had to bring in his brothers to run the company with him or not have anybody. So he goes to Buck Duke and he says, come on, let's do this secret deal here. You buy my company essentially, right? And you'll get me out of debt. I can continue growing. Nobody needs to know this. And while you do this, right,
I want you to buy up all my competitors, including the Haynes's. I bet you didn't know the Haynes were originally in tobacco. And in fact, Buck Duke bought out the Haynes's. So RJR did not have, right, the competitors in Winston or surrounds at all. Really, really shrewd. And publicly, he's like, it's really hard to have Buck Duke buy me out. This is a real problem. And yet, actually, it worked perfectly for him. Because Buck Duke didn't care a whit about chewing tobacco. He let RJR run the company as soon as he finished taking it up, and then he would bring R.J. Reynolds to New York, to Duke's corporate offices. And there in the corporate offices, R.J.R. learned about the new kind of way of doing business. And so here is this man in 1900 who's 50 years old, who's thought about retiring, but it's like, hey, no, there's a whole new way of doing business here where we can really ladder and reorganize how we work here. We can have marketing departments. We can have tobacco buying departments. We can have advertising departments. And he really thought about what corporate business was looking like based on what Duke was doing, and he brought it all back to Winston-Salem, and he reorganized R.J. Reynolds' company in the early 20th century. He was also going to be helped out by Katharine. I haven't forgotten her. I want to get you on this part of the story. And he was shrewd beyond belief because he knew when Buck Duke bought him out, he knew that the Supreme Court and the president were saying, look at that monopoly closely. Look very closely. He knew that was going on. He had signed a waiver that he couldn't ever go into cigarettes or pipe tobacco, but he knew that Duke was under such scrutiny that he went ahead with his own research on pipe tobacco and the flavorings for it, including saccharin, and on cigarettes as well. So by 1907, he just rolled out his pipe tobacco, the Prince Albert in a can, did really, really well. You can open magazines from this period and you can see the ads. Incredible, incredible success. And meanwhile, he had people working in his labs on cigarettes. And then 1909, the Supreme Court pulled the monopoly apart. RJR got the company back, and he was sitting pretty with a product that was doing really, really well. It was a more forward-thinking product, and cigarettes about ready to go. So it's just interesting to me that this crafty entrepreneurial guy who grew up in a very old world, right, an old, old, old world of plantation slavery, is able to transform himself into a late 19th century entrepreneur, into a 20th century corporate kind of guy. And meanwhile, he always chose to stay in Winston. Buck Duke, the others, went to New York, right? They went to that where the action was. R.J. Reynolds chose to be here. Okay. Move to Katharine Reynolds now. Remember, she's 30 years younger. So she grows up in Mount Airy. How many of you have ever been to Mount Airy? Oh, good. Okay. So here is Mount Airy. I wanted to show you the contrast in about 10 years' time. Remember, she was born in 1880. This is about 1890, and this is about 1900. Look at how quickly, right, in the late 19th, early 20th century, these places are changing. Look what new markets are bringing to a little tiny town like Mount Airy in just a short period of time. Katharine's father was an entrepreneur, too. She came by it naturally. He owned a tobacco warehouse as well as a farm, and he bought up all kinds of property in Mount Airy and sold it, sold commercial property as new businesses and manufacturers moved into the area. So he was one of the wealthiest, most powerful people in Little Mount Airy. He also was an investor in the Blue Ridge Hotel right here, fancy, fancy hotel. Not only was he an investor, so was his wife. And his wife had femme sole trader status. Now, I don't know, couldn't find out a lot about Katharine's mother, but the fact that she had legal status as femme sole trader in this way tells me she was pretty independent in her own right in the late 1890s. Katharine went to a little tiny private school, sort of a girls' finishing school, and there wasn't really public education at this point in that part of northern North Carolina. And then right as she was turning 15, the North Carolina public school movement put a public school in Mount Airy, but at first it was only for boys. Then the next year it went co-ed, and guess what? Nobody knew this, but I found it in the newspapers. The first class of girls at that school included Katharine. And the girl, and when the kids in 15, 16 year olds, when they were successful at this new graded school, public school, They were given titles. They were given military titles. And what I saw in the newspaper was Katharine would win a military, Colonel Kate. She went by Colonel Kate all the time, General Kate. She was very, very good. Colonel Kate was such a star that her principal wrote a letter for her to go to what was called the Normal Institute, the first white woman's college in North Carolina, public college in North Carolina. It's now UNCG. Before that, it was Women's College. Before that, it was called Normal Institute. Young women who wanted to be teachers and lift up whites in North Carolina, because remember, it's racial segregation, Jim Crow segregation, white schools only at this point, very limited schools, public schools for African-American children. If you wanted to make North Carolina a more progressive state and you were a young white woman, you went to Normal Institute and learned to be a teacher. So Katharine had that ambition, that progressive ambition from the get-go, and she went. She was very successful there. There were funny things that I found in the archives at UNCG. One of them was a memory by her roommate. Katharine could not stand her roommate's posture, and so she made her roommate sleep without a pillow because she said that would improve her roommate's posture. Katharine was a bit controlling even when she was 17 years old, is my point. Katharine was head of every social group that you can imagine. She was president or vice president and very one early in her career. So I could really see from the Normal Institute records who Katharine was. And then all of a sudden, she wasn't at Normal anymore. She had gone to another institution. She went to Sullins College in Western Virginia, and Bristol, Tennessee. And that was about as different from Normal Institute, which was all about being taught by these wonderful women professors from Bryn Mawr and Mount Holyoke, places like this, where this wonderful education. Then suddenly she's in Sullins, which is really a finishing school at the college level, where you're really supposed to find your husband. And she was only there 1 year. She was successful at everything. She was voted the faculty favorite, but she failed in finding a husband. And she moved back to Mount Airy, where she taught China painting, which was very popular at that time. She didn't make any money for it. She just did this. And she also told the president at Normal Institute, who she kept in touch with, she said, I'm eventually going to go to New York and be a painter. Rinalda House has one of her paintings. It's a practice painting. It's a good thing she didn't go to New York to do it, is what I would conclude. Okay, so here is Katharine as a young girl, and then she ends up marrying RJR. It's really interesting. They had, when she was at Normal Institute, the president of Normal would send her to Winston to R.J. Reynolds, her first cousin once removed, with her roommate to try and get him to give money to Normal Institute. So she had a relationship with him of some sort when she was in college. RJR eventually invites her to be one of his secretaries in the company, in R.J. Reynolds' company, first young woman secretary. She moves to Winston. She stays and lives with a married manager and his wife just about a block away from R.J. Reynolds, who is single, by the way. And I'm going to tell you something, and you can't tell anybody, or I'll have to kill you, okay? And that is, there are record books, account books, of R.J. Reynolds' personal account books. And they are in a special place, and I'll never get access to them again, but I did get access to them in 2004-2005. And what I could see in those personal account books of R.J. Reynolds is when Katharine became the secretary. In the accounts and the account books, you can see that the handwriting changes, and I knew Katharine's handwriting by then, so I knew completely it was Katharine's handwriting. And then you could see what RJR was spending money on and how much money she was making. So the first month, she made $30 a month. For about 4 months, she made $30. Then it was $35 a month. Then it was $40 a month. And the other thing that I could see is that Katharine was also learning how to invest from RJR, that she was taking the money she was making each month, and she was investing it in Wall Street. There's hardly anybody investing in Wall Street in the early 20th century, only the richest people. And there are like no women, and certainly not any 23-year-old women. And Katharine took her money, And she was able to, by the time she got married, 18 months after being secretary for R.J. Reynolds, she had over $10,000 that she had made off her investments. So she had a mind for the numbers, okay? Katharine had a mind for the numbers. There were other things that I found. This shows you how you can read account books. You don't think they'd be interesting. But there were other things. I would see where RJR got whole new suits of clothes, and Katharine was dressing. It was very clear that Katharine was dressing him. Curtains. There would be whole new, and because I would have his account books from earlier, there's nothing domestic, nothing apparel-wise at all. But once Katharine's in there, it all changes up. So I really could track the courtship, right, to where the money was going, as we were saying. So Katharine was very, very smart. So RJR marries Katharine in 1905. He's 54 years old. There's no heir. Think about this. There's no heir for this tremendously successful company. Thank God that Katharine was pregnant right away and had a child right away within like 11 months of marriage. And thank goodness it was a boy, because if you go in the R.J. Reynolds account of family papers, what you will see are like 600 telegrams from members of the company across the nation and other companies that did business with R.J. Reynolds saying, thank God you had a boy. Thank God there's going to be a future for R.J. Reynolds. And I thought to myself, what must it have been like for Katharine to feel that pressure, right? When you don't have sonograms, you don't know what the gender of your baby is going to be. She's hoping, please let it be a boy. So she has four children here. This is about 1911. So Dick Reynolds, Jr. is right here. Mary Reynolds, and then Nancy is up here, and the last baby is going to come in about a year and a half later. Okay, so now we're about 4 years later. This is 1914 with the whole family. Those of you who know Rinalda House really well know that Rinalda House tells a really wonderful story, thanks very much to Peggy Smith's really path-breaking, pioneering work about the importance of Katharine's ideas about sort of a progressive vision for this estate and what this estate could do and how it could help out a really impoverished rural part of Forsyth County. Because of tobacco manufacturing, because of industrialization, because of tobacco, families by the late 19th century had just literally farmed out their lands. They could barely get anything from it except that, you know, there were these smatterings of tobacco. People were buying their food. They didn't, you know, buying their food from the cities, not growing it themselves. So one of Katharine's contributions by creating her village was to really encourage farmers to practice more scientific farming. She was in touch with the federal government, in touch with North Carolina State, bringing in the best scientists, the best agriculturalists to think about how to really do progressive farming that used science that would be of benefit to all. And that's pictured up in the top corner here. Tuberculosis in dairy, in milk, was a real, real problem. Katharine worried about the health of her family and the health of other people. She brought in the first mechanical equipment for dairy farming that would make sure that the milk would be safe and healthy, and really sort of modeled the kind of farming that people should embrace. And then with working together with a landscape architect and Charles Barton Keene, Philadelphia-based architect who had worked with many estate owners of the time, really crafted an extraordinary estate, the likes of which this part of North Carolina had not seen. And it's really interesting in the letters. You can see where Katharine and RJ, by 1907, think about maybe going to outside of Baltimore or Philadelphia moving, but they decide to stay here. You can also see by 1908, 1909, that they're starting to buy pieces of land. Meanwhile, they had been living downtown Fifth Street, right where the library is today, in a big old Victorian that RJ and his brother had been living in. And they were buying up pieces of property, and most of those pieces of property were in Katharine's name. Even today, for married couples, and lawyers tell me this all the time, the property is in the name of both, but never in the married wife's name alone, even today in 2017. And here are some 29 pieces of property, most of which were all in Katharine's name alone, a few in her father's name, because people were figuring out that the Reynolds were buying up land and they were trying to keep the prices down. So they put it in her father's name, Smith, so nobody would know about it. So Katharine crafts this progressive estate in the 19-teens. She's foiled by World War I and prices going up. It slows down. She's also foiled by the fact that her husband has pancreatic cancer. cancer. She doesn't know that yet. Nobody knows that yet. But he's, by 1917, he's very sick. He's in hospitals in Baltimore and Philadelphia. She's also coming into her prime now. Her children are, she's had her four children. She has a lot of domestic help to take care of those children. And she's also really kind of pushing out there and leading different kinds of change. One of the things that she's doing is playing a big role in the advertising and marketing at R.J. Reynolds. She makes very good friends with N.W. Ayres, the leading marketing company in New York. And she's really framing what the camel advertising is going to look like. She's reading the text that goes out with the ads. And so she's really behind the scenes shaping how R.J. Reynolds is looking forward. She understood consumer taste. She loved shopping and buying things. And I really think that she was instrumental in figuring out how to position these new products going forward. She also was buying up lots of R.J. Reynolds stock herself. With her own money, in her own name, which was really, really smart. Because when RJR dies, the leadership at R.J. Reynolds is going to squeeze her out. Even though she has the most money, and she should technically have the power, they squeeze her out. She can't be on the board, and they give her a really, really hard time. The other thing that Katharine is doing in this period, not only is that she is managing this estate, there's 100 employees in the state. On this estate that she is really meticulously managing, paying attention to. She will fire and hire, and she brokered no fool at all. And if you think about it, there were very few companies in Winston that had 100 employees by comparison, and Katharine's managing all of this, even as she's helping with the R.J. Reynolds Company. And she's also very interested in progressive causes, relatively progressive because it's still Jim Crow segregation, and African-Americans do not have legal equality. They do not have social or cultural equality. But Katharine is paying attention to progressive efforts like the North Carolina Federation of Women's Clubs and their interest in women's voting and more care for a lot of death at this period for orphans and orphanages. So she's very interested in benevolent issues of that time. Okay, I'm going to move right ahead. Just to make the point that I was saying about the challenges of this time period, Winston grew very, very fast. Tobacco industry in particular was a dirty, nasty kind of work, and the industry was disproportionately dependent on African American labor. And not just here, but in Virginia, in Richmond, and Danville, and Lynchburg, these companies hired rural African-American sharecropping families, and they were willing to come from rural South Carolina and rural Virginia and work in these dangerous, dirty, nasty places in race-segregated work because they would get a wage. They would get a wage every Saturday, which you didn't get. Sharecropping, you would get caught in these terrible cycles of debt that you would be unable to get out of, because also there were new opportunities for your children. So Simon G. Atkins had moved to town. He created Slater Academy, and R.J. Reynolds supported Slater Academy. African-American children of the laborers could go to Slater Academy and get an education, usually a more skilled-oriented application as opposed to a kind of more liberal arts or general education. But nonetheless, it was a far cry from being in rural Virginia or rural South Carolina. So RJR really traded on that. That also meant that the demographics and the composition of the city changed very, very quickly, very, very dramatically. So the number of African Americans in the city, in the Third Ward, around the tobacco manufactories, grew enormously. RJR himself ran for city alderman for the Third Ward, and he won in the 1880s. In 1892, he lost to African American alderman. Right? So what was happening was the demographics were changing, the power was changing, more and more middle class and elite African Americans claiming more power, not just in Winston, but in cities around the South. And the way that the white leadership responded is violence, is to threaten violence. So when there was a race riot because of bad treatment of an African American man wrongfully accused of rape in 1896, the Winston leaders went to Charlotte and got a Gatling gun so that they could really kind of threaten that community. Another way that the white leadership reinforced its authority was through imprisonment. I mean, you think about the challenges that we talk about imprisonment today, incarceration. So African Americans were incarcerated at extraordinary rates for crimes that I think you and I would think were not crimes at all. And then they were hired out as labor, as cheap labor. Katharine took advantage of that cheap labor. That is Rinalda Road. Katharine was tired of it being a dirt road. And so she made a deal, right, with the county that she would provide the gravel and things you needed to make macadam, and they would give her the convict labor to build Rinalda Road, which I cannot ever forget when I go down Rinalda Road. Another way to read this is she's the only woman I know who did this. So Katharine was, you know, she was playing with the big boys and figuring out how to make this happen. So complicated, because it's complicated in another way. Here is Simon Atkins, the founder of Winston-Salem State, Slater Academy, and his wife. This is one of their first graduating classes. RJR understood that if he was going to make his manufactory work, he was going to have to make sure that his African-American labor force did not leave Winston-Salem and go north to New York, go north to Detroit, go north to these other opportunities. And there were agents from those companies, from the car manufacturers and other companies coming down here and saying, you're in a racist, horrible place. Jim Crow segregation, you're not getting the right wages, you need to leave. And RJR had to deal with that, because if his, and of course African-American labor in this Jim Crow world was cheaper than white labor, okay, RJR couldn't do this without having this cheap source of labor. So what RJR recognized was that he could community build and keep some of his laborers from leaving. So one of the ways to do that was to support Slater Academy and Simon Atkins' vision. And in fact, in Simon Atkins' paper at Winston-Salem State, Simon Atkins has letters where he's writing to white philanthropists in New York and in Boston, and he's saying, look, there is an industrialist, a white industrialist from the South, and he has committed $5,000 to my Slater Academy matching. Can you come up? If he can do it, basically, if this white Southerner in Jim Crow segregation can do it, you up in Boston can ante up. So RJR understood that making a philanthropic commitment in this way had real significance in a society where white industrialists were not doing this. This is what kind of complicates the story. He also, because I have those account books, I could see that he gave money equally to white and black organizations, churches, orphanages, equally all over the place, again and again and again. Some people would argue that, well, he must not have been as racist as we thought he was. I say we have to complicate that, because it certainly supported his interests given the challenges that he had. And down in this corner, the children from the Rinalda Estate School. There was a school for white children and a school for African-American children. Now, what was interesting in the Rinalda family papers that I found was that the African-American teachers all came from, were all college educated from the best HBCUs. The children, white and black, from these schools played together at lunchtime. Their textbooks were the same in the white and black schools. So again, a complicating factor in all of this. And that was Katharine's vision to do the schools in this way. I'm just about finished here. This is Katharine in this beautiful car. The General Federation of the North Carolina Federation of Women's Club met in Winston-Salem. 200, 300 progressive white women leaders came there. Katharine always supported this. She never was the president, but she was the head of hospitality, and she provided her car, and she had this for the president of the Women's Federation, which they came through town. Katharine would reinvent herself, even though she lived a short life to only 43. She would reinvent herself. Think about that opening image where I showed you in that Parisian Victorian gown, right, that was very 19th century. Here she is in her early 40s. She's too old to be a flapper, but the bare arms, the sensuous feather that she's holding here, Katharine was always reinventing herself again and again. And RJR dies of pancreatic cancer in 1918. Katharine, at that year, 1917, 1918, Katharine had been asked to be the
chairwoman of the Liberty Bond Drive in North Carolina. She was going all over the state, very powerful position. She ended up turning it over because her husband was so sick. She also was asked by President Wilson to be on the ASSAY, A-S-S-A-Y committee that goes to the Philadelphia Mint to make sure the money is done properly. It's an honorific. But she was the first woman ever to be asked to go to the Philadelphia Mint to make sure that it was being taken care of, you know, that it was being minted properly. So Katharine was really coming into her own over World War I, coming into her own as a white woman progressive leader. And then her husband died in 1918. She was still building her school at that point. She thought about, she loved him. There's no doubt in my mind that both of them loved each other very much. After his death, Katharine was trying to decide whether to pursue her school or not, and she decided to go ahead with it. And she needed a principal for the school. She was being supported by the superintendent of Forsyth County. She needed a principal for the school, and he brought in a young veteran who had been educated at Davidson College and introduced him to Katharine, said, you know, he might be the perfect person for your new principal for this school. His name was J. Edward Johnston, and yes, he's pretty much drop-dead gorgeous, and he's 12 years younger than Katharine, and it's very clear within about a year, 6 months or so, that there were sparks flying. So Katharine, reinventing herself, married this much younger man in 1921. She had been told never to have children anymore, that her heart couldn't take it, that she wasn't healthy enough. She did have another child with J. Edward Johnston. It's very clear to me she wanted to have that child. That baby died at birth. And then in 1923, she was pregnant again with a child. And she had that baby. She was put on bed rest in New York. She moved and was in the hospital on bed rest for 3 months, had the baby. J. Edward Johnston sends telegram back to the children here, her children with R.J. Reynolds, that everything is fine, and she dies 3 days later of an embolism, probably because they didn't get her out of bed and move her around, but she dies at 43. The thing that I want to close out here with is this thought about Katharine Reynolds, and that is that if Katharine Reynolds had lived into her 50s and into her 60s with the kind of wealth that she had and the kind of mind that she had and the kind of energy that she had, I always wonder what she would have done, what she could have done, what way she might have changed kind of Winston-Salem and the kinds of contributions she might have made in Winston and beyond. At her death, her body was brought back to Winston by train. People from the city met the train when it came to town. And then on the day of her funeral, the whole city shut down. The whole city shut down, as they had for R.J. Reynolds when he died in 1918. The schools closed, the government buildings closed, businesses closed. But they did this for a woman in the Deep South in 1924. And hundreds, and the papers say thousands, lined Reynolds Road all the way to Salem Cemetery in honor of her death. So there were sermons for her. 6 different ministers gave sermons. The lead minister was the minister of Home Moravian Church, and he called Katharine a woman for a new day. And really said exactly what I said. If she had lived, what might she have done? So I've talked a long time. I'm going to stop right there. Okay, thank you. It's so good. Audience, thank you. Thank you. So I was supposed to talk 40 minutes, and I think I talked 47 minutes. Sorry, Tim. Any questions or any thoughts? You understand my point? How progressive were they? That's a challenge to think about. They're not as progressive as we might like to be. Yes?
I'm really curious about her children and their children, I guess, after they both died. There's 4 of them, and they're all, I presume,
there
under
18. There are 5.
Yeah, 5. You're right. I'm sorry. All under 18. So what kind of happens to those children after they both died?
Well, one of the things that I said when I did this book was that Katharine and R.J. were dead by 1924, and to go to the next generation was like just a little too close for comfort for me, because I really had been trained as an 18th and 19th century historian. But everyone has asked me that question, so I have explored that more. Dick Reynolds grew up the oldest child. None of them ever worked for the company. They never needed to work. They inherited J. Edward Johnston, the husband, and then the J. Edward Johnston Jr., the baby, each received a sixth of Catherine's estate, and then her four children with RJR received a sixth of the estate. So they were all very, very comfortable. Dick Reynolds grew up and became very interested in business and aviation, as did the youngest child, Smith. And Dick also was very, very interested in yachting and yachted all around the world. But he did come back and made a commitment. He was mayor of Winston-Salem, and actually he helped fund FDR's election the third time, when FDR was elected the third time, and was really a powerful player in the Democratic Party. He became an alcoholic. He married four times. And he died of his alcoholism. He had multiple children. Mary Reynolds Babcock died in the early 50s of cancer. She married Babcock from Philadelphia. Peggy can do this faster than me, I think. Am I doing okay?
Thank you.
Okay. And her husband, Mary Reynolds Babcock's husband, was a real leader in Winston, and probably he probably is owed a biography in his own right. And then she died of cancer. Nancy Susan Reynolds lived mostly in Connecticut, but was very committed to the house and to the museum and to getting a book of the R.J. Reynolds Company written. And I think she's probably one of the most interesting of the children. And then Smith Reynolds dies in 1932. J. Edward, under mysterious circumstances, J. Edward Johnston Jr. Grew up away from the Reynolds family, grew up in Baltimore, and I got to meet him in 2004, 2005, and he gave me the love letters between his mother and his father, which was really special. And it was really freaky when I met him, because when I met him, I could see how he was a child. You know, literally seeing him, he had mannerisms and his looks of both Catherine and J. Edward Johnston. And the thing he said to me, even though he'd never met his mother, but he'd heard people talk, he said, "You know, you have to remember first and foremost about her, she was a businesswoman." And that really stuck with me, and because when I saw the meticulousness of the way she kept her records. And the Reynolds family is a very big family. There's a lot. And I think you can look at three generations of Reynolds women and think about what Barbara Milhouse has done with the Rinalda House estate as the former executive director and the creation of that incredible American Art Museum as kind of the legacy that Catherine created with her granddaughter and the things that she did with that wonderful museum.
I'm curious why she would have gone from normal college to Solent.
Yeah,
it seems like coming down, doesn't it?
But I think a couple things were going on. Her mother was ill with tuberculosis, and so Catherine was kind of going back and forth between normal and home. And so I don't know if that kind of she got less interested in her commitment to being, to thinking she wanted to be a teacher. Her younger sister also started school at Sullins, so I don't know if her parents said, "Look, you know, your sister doesn't want to do normal school, but she wants to go to Sullins. Why don't you go finish at Sullins?" And also, Catherine's uncle was in Bristol and was had a manufacturer there, a business there, and so there was family there. So There's no burning letter that explains this for me, so we have to kind of speculate all these different pieces. But she was, she was kind of running the show there. Yes?
Did Johnston Sr. leave the RJR's children almost immediately after she died?
That's a great question. So everyone told me that J. Edward Johnston was just a jerk, and that he was just after her money, and that he was kind of an execrable figure. And that's what people told me about 10 years ago. And everything that I've seen in the record suggests otherwise. He was very close with the daughters. They called him Papa, and he stayed in touch. He was with the children's Uncle Will, RJR's brother. They had joint legal custody of them for a very long time. His mother lived on Rinalda Road, just down the road from the Rinalda estate, and he actually was in Winston for much longer than everyone had told me that he was. J. Edward Johnson Jr. did tell me that Will Reynolds had J. Edward Johnson Sr. beat up to make him leave town. He was, I don't know if that's true or not, that's what I was told. J. Edward Johnson Sr. was, of course, very handsome, still, you know, he was a widower, had a lot of money, and a lot of women in Winston were very interested in him in 1925, 26, 27. He ended up going to Baltimore. He married a woman who was widowed as well and had two more children in Baltimore. so he was here, he was on the board of the YMCA, and there were other ways that he was really a community citizen for about 3 or 4 years after Katharine died.
Yes. Michele, you said that you got to see RJ's account books in 0405, and you'll never be able to see them again.
I don't know where they are now.
Yeah, so
I can't
why
tell
is
you
that?
Too much. All I can tell you,
another story.
Yeah, all I can tell you is someone knew I was working on this project, and someone knew where they were, and someone gave me access to them for about 6 weeks. And I was so stupid, I didn't photograph them. I took notes from them. So I have extensive notes about this. And if you look in my book, you will see I cite them in the footnotes, but I never cite them in the bibliography because I can't tell you where they are. And I figure if anyone ever wants to know, they will write me, and I can share with them copies of my yellow tablet notes.
So they could just walk down the street.
They can.
I could walk down the street, knock on your door.
Yeah, and I would share them with you. So I'm not, but I don't know where they are, and some people think they don't exist anymore. So
interesting.
Yeah. The image of the camel seems so exotic and so powerful, but in those days the circus would come to town. When the circus came to town, right, everything stopped, all the businesses closed, everybody went out to see the animals get off the train and get marched through the streets, which would have been pretty cool to see the camels and the lions and the elephants march through the streets. And the marketing person at R.J. Reynolds saw the camel. I mean, this is a sort of famous story. He saw the camel, thought, you know, this would be a great opportunity to, and had the photograph taken. So that really was not as exotic, maybe, as one might have expected. Nobody went to, went to the Middle East to search down camels and figure out the imagery.
Well, except that one of the pictures that you showed of the camel had said it was
Turkish,
cigarette,
right.
So, what were their international connections?
They were really interesting. That's a great question. There were strong international connections. He was sending his salespeople and his marketers all throughout Europe into the Middle East. Katharine and the family almost went to China with RJR because tobacco was being grown there and for new markets. So there's a whole story about early globalization through the company, through tobacco, that I think that could be told. And then even just the use of the exotic images of the minaret and the pyramid, etc. There are more stories to be told there. Yeah,
and it's a dromedary too, isn't it?
It is a dromedary. That's right. That's right. Yes.
I'm just going to say that I'm actually working on that Turkish.
Oh, that's great.
Tobacco right now, and when cigarettes came in, they needed a lighter tobacco, and the Turkish tobacco fit in with that, so they had companies buying it in Greece and Turkey, and they thought they couldn't be trusted, so R.J. Reynolds started its own subsidiary over there to buy that Turkish tobacco.
And there are whole towns that are dedicated to tobacco manufacturing, even today, or tobacco sales, even today.
And not just R.J. Reynolds, but there are a lot of tobacco companies that have Turkish tobacco to sort of be in.
So Peggy's going to be, she's going to be up here next to tell us that.
So going on to this camel, I'm not a smoker, but I never have. But I'm looking at it right now. I'm finding an advertisement for the New York Times from 1915 for camels. But they say, don't they not even now say it's non-filter, right? That's their thing. They advertise that they're like a non-filter, so it's like a pure tobacco. So is that unique for the time in terms of cigarettes.
Well, I don't think cigarettes were filtered.
They were filtered at all. Yeah. But so then they weren't filtered. But then, well, why did Camel continue to be not filtered now?
Talk about sort of the morality of R.J. Reynolds and tobacco, right? I mean, sort of overriding all of this. And I would say, I mean, R.J. R. smoked himself, but
they all smoked.
But R.J. R. told his family, his children, never to smoke. They did anyway as teenagers and after he was gone. But he always told them, never, never smoke. And I don't think it was, I mean, R.J. R. was a pretty rough guy, right? He liked hunting, and he liked horse races, and it wasn't because he thought it was inappropriate for his family social class. I think he began to recognize that that tobacco products were not healthy. But we didn't have the information that we did by the 1940s and 1950s.
He had a child outside of marriage.
He did.
And do you know anything about that?
Yes. Yeah, I do. He probably had other children, but the one child
that he
recognized, I was able to trace that child. The child was born in a couple, it was like 8 years younger than Katharine, and the family story is that he and a friend went hunting on a farmer's property, and he had a liaison and evening with the farmer's daughter. The farmer's daughter was pregnant. He paid for her to go away, and then that child grew up in an orphanage. And but when the child was about 10 or 12, that child appeared in those account books. And RJR was paying him to collect pasture fees. RJR owned a farm in East Winston, and he would rent out pasture fees for people to raise their cows and their horses. And so he had his young son, his illegitimate son, doing the pasture fees for him, learning the business. And you could also see when he would buy new clothes for this young man as a teenager. You could also see when he paid for him to go to school. And that son ended up coming into the business and running the office out of Omaha. And he died. Sadly enough, the family knew about him, and Katharine knew about him. And there are letters between Katharine and the son as RJR is dying. And Katharine has clearly said, come home and say goodbye. And so these are sort of very powerful letters between the two of them, where they're not exactly acknowledging who he is, but she's making sure that he has a chance to say goodbye. While RJR and his brother were out at Tanglewood, there was a sort of spur there for railroad cars, and the grown-ups were out hunting, and the boy was on the railroad track, and a car slipped off from its connection and pinned his leg, and he lost his leg. So he grew up without a leg. He winds up in Omaha. He gets the flu or pneumonia and dies, and he has an estate of over $600,000, which is a huge amount of money. And he gives, whereas RJR gives $500,000 to the city of Winston for two hospitals, an African-American hospital and a white hospital. And actually, that money was never used for the African American hospital. The white hospital was built, and a wing for African Americans was added to it, but nowhere near equal as RJR had intended. RJR's illegitimate son, Neil, John Neal, has $600,000, and he commits the money to two orphanages. And he says, I'm giving this money to these orphanages because I never want children to grow up hungry like I did. And so you think about RJR not acknowledging his child for so long, and that child growing up hungry, and then giving back in that way to these orphanages, which was the biggest philanthropic gift that Winston had received, a single gift, you know, more than his own father who had died from the war. Great question.
I apologize for asking two questions, but I've heard with a great friend that you're working on a book on Libby Coleman.
Yeah.
And I wondered if you could give us any kind of sneak peek.
Yeah, well, I'm just going to say, so Libby Holman was the youngest son, Smith's second wife before he was even 20, and she was 6 years older than Smith was, and she was a Broadway revue singer, a torch singer. She grew up in Cincinnati. Her father was a lawyer. She was very smart, and she ends up marrying Smith, right before he does his 6-month global flight through the world, and then they come back to Winston for 6 weeks, and her brand new husband is dead. And so people wonder what her role was. She is fascinating because, talk about reinvention, she reinvents herself multiple times, again and again and again, and she is committed to issues of civil rights. At the same time that I would argue she appropriates African-American culture and African-American identity to create sort of a new way of presenting herself in the world. So that's a biography that tells us, that's going to tell us also about kind of white appropriation of black culture across the 20th century in sort of construction of modernity that I'm excited about working with. That's probably a good place to start, so these poor people can go.
Well, thanks, Michele. Let's go.